Good evening, everybody.
Evening.
It's a pleasure to see you all. You all have a copy of the agenda, I trust. The minutes of the supervisors' meeting of September 2. We have a motion to accept.
I move we approve.
I'll second.
Okay, any discussion?
I sent Lisa a couple of minor changes.
All in favor?
Aye.
I as well, so that passes unanimously. Lisa, would you tell us about the executive session and then lead to the manager's report, please?
The Board of Supervisors met this evening at 7:15 to discuss a matter of litigation, which is on the agenda for later on in the evening. For the manager's report, I wanted to announce that we have a zoning hearing board case September 23rd at 7 p.m. The applicant is Renee and Charlie Cuno at 308 Kennett Pike, and they have a non-conforming lot. They're requesting relief from the township code in regards to the side yard setback to construct the garage. So that's a public hearing. Anybody that wants to attend. We have a hearing scheduled for October 7th at 7 p.m. at the beginning of the supervisors' meeting, and that's for a petition for a zoning ordinance amendment from Walnut Street Development Partners. And they are asking that the VP district be amended to permit residential use in that district. So that'll be October 7th at 7 p.m. I wanted to announce that today our Mike Gutman, our grants coordinator, and I spent the day in Harrisburg, and we met with several representatives from the state and staff members to discuss the multimodal grant that we applied for, which the CFA will be reviewing the applications in November. So it seemed to be well received, which was good news. And at the September 2nd meeting, we talked about a traffic impact study that we wanted to do to be able to levy fees on developments, to be able to assist in the maintenance of roads and upkeep new roads. Right now, we don't have any type of mechanism to assess those fees on developments, and all of the traffic is really a burden on our roads. Our engineer submitted an estimate for, it was about $60,000 for the traffic impact study. The supervisors approved to move forward with that. I agreed to check other municipalities that have it in place to ask them how much they have spent on the study. And I checked about 10 municipalities, and they all range from about $65,000 to $85,000. Now, I don't know the details of their study, but I spoke to their managers about a general traffic impact study. At the last meeting, we also received approval to obtain a property up to $100,000 that was going up for sale. That sale, it was going up for sheriff's sale. That sale has been canceled. And until further notice, we won't be doing anything about that property.
Thank you. Chief, would you like to
Sure.
your report, please?
Plug it in first.
That does help, right?
Details.
I think we should be in business. Good evening, folks. August 2015 police report. The Kennett Township Police Department, in conjunction with the Pennsylvania State Police, provided police service to 312 emergency incidents in the municipality of Kennett during August 2015. 87 of those incidents were handled by the State Police Barracks in Avondale. In the month of August, again, we continue to investigate numerous daytime forced entry burglaries. It's an ongoing problem. We encourage the residents to utilize their alarms, surveillance systems, secure their doors to help prevent being a victim of this type of crime. The police department also requests if you see suspicious condition to report your activity to 911. So if you see any suspicious people, please call 911 so you get an immediate police response. Also, take a look at the police website if you have questions about crime prevention tips. There's some tips on there to help you secure your residence and prevent yourself from being a victim of that type of crime. The police department completed a wave of aggressive driving that ran from July 6th to August 30th. During the tenure of the enforcement, we issued 102 traffic citations for aggressive types of driving. The top speed violation was in excess of 33 miles an hour above the posted speed limit. The police department participated in two highway sobriety checkpoints, which were conducted throughout Chester County as part of the Chester County Impaired Driving Program. The school season has started, so we remind motorists to be aware that school is now in session. Please pay the posted 15-mile-an-hour school zone, school bus signals, and watch for school students as they travel up and down the street. And have a safe and prosperous month of September. And that's all I have for this month. Questions?
Thank you, Aaron. Yes.
Can I actually ask? Sure. So what kind of surveillance systems can I have in my house? Because when I talked to the state police years ago, they told me I couldn't have cameras out posted watching my property. So what can I have?
I'm not sure who provides you that information. That's actually incorrect.
Okay.
You can have any type of surveillance on your property that you would like. So any camera system that's generated from the confines of your property mm-hmm. is a legal surveillance system.
And do I need to have it posted that I'm filming you or watching or?
You do not.
Okay.
Now you are not permitted to collect the audio of that portion, just okay. the surveillance. So if you install cameras on your house, you're well within your rights to do so.
Okay.
Yeah,
thanks.
Thank you.
I had a question for the chief.
Yes.
So for the calls handled for the month, is the total about the same or higher total? Because you guys are handling more than the state police?
The 2014 was 249 and year to date is 312, so we're there's a considerable increase for this month.
Right, but is that because we've got more officers around?
Some of that is self-initiated officer activity, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions or comments for Chief?
Yes, sir.
Chair Duffy, Kennett Township. You know, the bridge is out, of course, at Burnt Mill. And the detour comes around Spring Mill.
Yes.
And that's like a race track now. So if you guys need something to do, come on down and
hang out by your house or by you.
Yeah,
I agree with you. There's a
after the bridge, between the bridge and up there at Norway, it's like they're zooming down there.
You basically almost doubled the amount of traffic on that particular road closure. No, we'll put some cars out that way.
Thanks.
And maybe another question? I'm sorry.
No, I'm totally unrelated. But so with your investigations of the break-ins, are there any leads? Can you follow a pattern? I mean, are they all like sit next to Whitney? But we're kind of on the end of the township where I believe most of the break-ins are happening over toward Hammerton. And so anyway.
We're still in a very active part of the investigation, but I will say that we have significant amount of evidence and arrests are forthcoming. It's just a matter of time. I don't want to get a lot of details
about
the
understand.
Investigation, but
okay.
We do have a significant amount of evidence.
Okay.
Question?
Thank you, Chief Nault, for an informative and interesting report. That brings us to old business. comprehensive plan amendments.
The Board of Supervisors adopted the comprehensive plan on July 1st, which the Planning Commission and many other committees in the township have been working on for over 2 years. We had decided at that meeting that there were some minor changes that needed to be made to a few of the sections in the comp plan, which were for Section 2, for planning and implementation, we needed to add the Trails and Sidewalk Committee and the Land Conservation Advisory Committee to a few of the objectives. We added the Open Space Trails, Parks, and Recreation under, in that section, we added sidewalks as an objective. And we added some key parties that weren't in there, like the Ways Lane Committee, the Route 52 Bikeway Committee. We added the Underground Railroad as a historic resource in Chapter 5. We added ash tree management in Chapter 6 as a scenic resource. We also increased the action item for water resources. And we added some other, there were some grammar that needed to be corrected, and there are a couple words that needed to be changed in the Parks, Rec, and Trails plan. So they were all minor changes. These changes were sent back to the Planning Commission to approve them, who recommended them for approval. They were sent back to the Chester County Planning Commission and the other committees in the township. So tonight we're asking that the board take a vote to implement the comprehensive plan with the changes.
I have a question for you. All right, well, first of all, do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
So I have a question for you, Lisa. Chapter 2 implementation, was that part of the original adoption?
Yes.
Sorry?
All of the chapters. We amended that.
Okay. The implementation of Chapter 2 was amended?
Yes, we added two parties to that.
All right, because as you go down through the list of key parties, it says Planning Commission, which conflicts with, if I understand the policies Chapter 2 section, the implementation refers to the Planning Commission as the primary, whereas when you get implementation progress reports, it makes reference to Kennett Township Board of Supervisors.
Can you go back to the first part you were talking about?
Sure. Implementation actions.
Yes, they have.
And then under key parties,
right,
the column is showing.
Right.
Not the Board of Supervisors, but the Planning Commission.
But it's showing a lot of committees.
Right, but every one of them, virtually every one of them, says Planning Commission.
Well, there's a lot. Yes, there's a lot to say Planning Commission. The part that we had changed was the implementation progress, how the table in the other part of Chapter 2.
Correct.
Because it initially said that it would be up to the Planning Commission then to analyze it on an annual basis and what the next steps would be. And I thought it was understood we wanted the supervisors to be able to do that.
Absolutely.
But they still have to be listed as a key party with all the other committees so that they have a part in the comp plan.
Okay, so they're not the primary.
No, they're just in each section.
Interested player.
Correct. Just like it shows here, the EAC is Kennett Area Park and Rec, the Trails and Sidewalk, Open Space Committee. There's key parties for every section of the comp plan.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. All right, so are there any other comments or questions?
So the vote would be to authorize our solicitor to move forward drafting an ordinance that will implement these changes, and then if the, can it be done at the next meeting, or is it going to be twice?
No, it's got to be done, it's got to be twice.
So at the October 21st meeting, that ordinance will be placed on the agenda.
And is that what your motion said?
I guess it does now.
That second, how was it?
I will second that changed amendment, motion.
Are there any comments or questions from anybody else? Okay, hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, passes, thank you. Next business, matter of old business is a tax assessment appeal settlement for $1.65 million.
At its last meeting, the Board of Supervisors authorized the settlement of a pending filed tax assessment appeal that is in the Court of Common Pleas right now for no less than a fair market value of $1.8 million. The attorney for the County Board of Assessment Appeals has been in negotiations with the appealing property owner and has obtained authority from the county to settle the case for a fair market value of the property not less than $1.65 million. And I would request a motion to authorize the settlement of the case for a fair market value of the property not less than $1.65 million.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Passes unanimously. Thank you. That brings us to the matter of new business. Is there a motion that we pay our bills?
No, we'll vote for that too.
Sounds like a good idea. Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Lisa, do you want to tell us about pension minimum municipal obligation, the infamous MMO?
Yes, on an annual basis, I have to provide the supervisors with the amount of the pension cost for the next year. So it's due into our pension system administrator by October 1st. For the office staff and road department for 2016, the pension's expected to be $94,721. For the police department, it's expected to be $44,560. This amount totals $112,000, and it's expected that we'll receive about $42,000 in state aid, which will offset it for a total cost of $70,000.
Net cost.
Net cost. And this is due by the end of 2016.
Okay. We have a motion to do that.
I don't need a motion. I just have to inform you.
Okay. So we have to, don't have to take any specific action.
I have informed.
I have to inform you by October 1st.
And this will keep us up to where we're supposed to be on
be
our pension fund.
Yes.
Thank you.
Our pension is funded, fully funded.
All right. Thank you. Resolution 2015-18, the Ashford sewer rates.
Bob, do you want me to do that? Or?
Yeah, please.
For the Ashford sewer system, which is a sewer system that's on Route 52 over near Route 1, this system, I don't know how many of you are familiar with it. I know a few people that live there here, and they're very familiar. But this system had a lot of issues in the beginning, and it wasn't installed properly. The township ended up having to take over the system to fix it. We ended up spending about $400,000 now. That's not an exact number right now, but it's close to that on this system. There's 20 homes that are connected to the system, and the township bills them quarterly for the sewer usage. About 3 years ago, we had a meeting with the residents, and it was agreed that over a period of time, the sewer rates would be slightly increased each year. So last year, the sewer rate was $525, which started the third quarter of 2014. Resolution 2015-18 is to increase it to $541 per quarter, beginning the third quarter of 2015.
I move we approve Resolution 2015-18.
I was going to say that, all the other sewer districts in the township are billed at a rate that the borough bills the township, which is $10.35 per 1,000 gallons for some. And it's, I don't know the exact number off the top of my head, but it's around $11 for other systems. They aren't increased annually because we don't own those systems, and we don't have the maintenance for the systems like we do for Ashford. The other systems service a total of 1,000 residents. Ashford only services 20. The other thing with Ashford is right now our engineering firm is looking at to see what future costs would be needed for Ashford, if there's any preventative maintenance we can do to lower the cost, and any alternatives. We looked at this 3 years ago, but we're looking at it again just to keep trying to find some way to lower the cost.
I got two different questions.
Well just one. There was a motion made.
Okay.
And
that's fine.
But it has not been seconded yet, and then it'll be appropriate for discussion.
And I'll second it.
Thank you.
I mean, it seems like about a 3% increase.
It is
3%, exactly.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
So just the two questions. One, I know one of the 20 homes doesn't pay.
That's correct.
And I know you have, I assume, a lien or something against the home. Is there any other way to make that person pay?
Soon.
But is that us as the homeowners that are on the system, or?
I mean, a lien is a way to collect a municipal debt, obviously.
Right.
You place a lien on the property. The other way, if you file a suit against them and get a judgment, you can convert the judgment to, you can execute on the judgment. And try to collect it by exposing it to sheriff's sale, etc.
So I could do that personally. I mean, that would be funny, but I could do that personally and then pay back the township, or the township has to?
No, the township has to do it.
Okay.
You don't, I don't think you have the requisite interest in the...
Well, I guess
you have an interest, but it's not a direct interest.
I gotcha.
The person doesn't pay you, they
right.
pay the township.
Right. And then my second question is, I know one of the other neighbors came to you with a possible alternative.
That's correct.
So I don't know if you've gone down that path and tried to do a cost analysis. Obviously.
We did.
Okay.
And our engineer reviewed it and found that it wasn't going to be more efficient than the current system, and it was going to cost a lot more money to implement it since we just put in...
Right, you did, yeah. I gotcha.
So we did have the two, that was an engineer.
Yes.
And we had the two engineers work together
okay.
to see if they could come up with something.
That's fair. Okay, just didn't know where that wound up, so thank you.
He reported back to him, and he was going to tell the residents as well.
He kind of, last time I talked to the neighbor, he just kind of said, oh, we're still on hold, waiting to see. So maybe you just kind of let it go after a while. But that's fine. Thank you.
Lisa, I would like to have a report back on the person that she's talking about and find out where we are.
I'll get Tom Wilkes to
There's no reason for that to go on.
Yeah, it hasn't. It was finalized. So I'll ask Tom Wilkes.
Oh, the problem's been solved?
It was. Tom Wilkes worked with the person that one of the residents knew that's an engineer. And Tom worked through it, and it was communicated back to him that the system wouldn't work.
Well, I'm talking about the person who has not been paying the bill.
Oh, that, well, we have a lien on the property.
Oh, we do.
We've worked with Dave on it, we have a lien on the property, and we update it every year.
Okay, how large is that at this point, do you know?
I think it's about $8,000.
Wow. How long's it been going on?
Knocks on the door and takes some refrigerator.
How long's it been going on?
About four years.
About 4 years, then.
Two thousand a year. No, it seems inappropriate. I'm saying this as gently as I can. It seems inappropriate that the vast majority of the residents are paying their bill, their collective bills, and there's one that is not. And I think that...
It's a hard rate. It's a high rate and hard to swallow, but at the same time, if you're saying, you know, they're part of the system.
If the person is just thumbing his or her nose at us, that's one thing. And if there's a reason why they can't pay the increases, then that's a different thing. But we need to, I think...
I'm not sure what more we can do. We've discussed it with Dave, and our best avenue was to place a lien and update the lien annually, because if we went to a sheriff's sale, you know, you really don't get that much from contents. It wouldn't be the house, it would be the contents.
Yeah, and you can't just, well, it could be the house, but you don't just go to sheriff's sale. You have to file a complaint, have it served in the court of common pleas, give them notice, and if they don't file a response, you can take a default judgment eventually. All of that costs money to do. You can put all your costs into the judgment, so you can get the cost back, but then you have a judgment that you need to execute on. What could happen is they could file an answer to the complaint, and then we've got to litigate the issue of what they owe and why they owe it, and it's our burden as a township to go forward and prove that they are delinquent on their payment of the assessment, and which I don't think we have trouble doing, but, you know, A, time, and B, money. It's just easier and cheaper to do the lien, but if the township is saying, we're not going to take it anymore, we're not content to just put a lien on the property, you can authorize the start of a suit.
We'll talk about it.
Okay. It's money chasing money, so I can understand that. It's, you know.
Whitney Hoffman, Ashford resident. One of the things that I would love to have the engineer look into, again, not only for Ashford, but for the septic systems in and around, whether they're private or they're quasi-public like ours, is what can we do, and can the township and the engineers provide us any guidance with care and maintenance? So are there things that we can do to prolong the life of the system?
We can provide that information. We absolutely can.
I think that would be great and helpful to everybody.
Is there any other discussion? Any other questions?
I just wanted to, Whitney, when we send out new resident packets when people move in, and we do send some information on that. It's just a one-page sheet, but our engineer might have something more detailed.
Yeah, it might be helpful just to remind people, because frankly, you know, it was not a township system necessarily when I moved in over 11 years ago, so I don't remember ever getting anything like that.
I think you've sent it out before at one point during one of the meetings when we were trying to determine alternatives and stuff like that, but people do forget, so it might not be. Maybe even slip it in with the fourth quarter sewer bill or something.
I don't know. And the other unfortunate part of that is that I've talked to a couple residents that moved in there recently, and from what I understand, the realtor never told them about the system and the cost.
Well, it's listed as public.
Right.
And it is, and it really technically public because you own it, but then so people think, oh, and then they get that first quarter bill and, you know, hit the floor.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? I'll call for the vote. All in favor of adopting resolution 2015-18, say aye.
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 And aye as well. So it passes unanimously. Thank you. That brings us to what some of the people in this room have been waiting for, I believe, standard conditional use hearing decision.
Recall that two members of the Board of Supervisors sat and heard what ended up to be two full hearings and one very abbreviated third hearing on the conditional use application of Stan Ab LP. A decision was prepared and circulated to the Board of Supervisors for review and to the parties for review, and it would be appropriate at this time for Supervisors Hamaker and Leff to entertain or contemplate making a motion to grant the application of Stan Ab LP for a conditional use for an apartment use in the BP Business Park Zoning District, subject to the following conditions, which I will read at length. First, that the applicant shall locate the proposed swimming pool and amenities deck, including whirlpool and barbecues, within the interior amenity deck area of the proposed apartment building. Secondly, that the applicant shall move the western internal roadway 15 feet to the east of its current location depicted on the plan submitted with the application to bring it to a total of 40 feet from Mr. Kaiser's property line. Third, the applicant shall plant a second row of trees which shall be planted as high as possible on the berm required by section, the fourth condition below, beginning at a point 40 lineal feet south of Kaiser's property and ending at a point 10 lineal feet north of Kaiser's property. Fourth, that the applicant shall construct an earthen berm with a height between 4 and 5 feet, beginning at a point 40 lineal feet south of Kaiser's property and ending at a point 10 lineal feet north of Kaiser's property. Fifth, that the applicant shall keep all lighting on the western internal roadway at the minimum allowed by the township, exceeding current ordinance requirements where allowed by the township, in respect to the distance between light poles and the height of the light poles. In addition, the light poles shall be installed with lighting shields, and the lights shall use a light source that reduces in wattage at a certain time of the night, if permitted by the township. Sixth, neither the applicant nor Kaiser shall file an appeal from this decision as long as the plan that is ultimately approved is the same or substantially similar to the testimony and evidence presented at the conditional use hearing. Seventh, if the applicant proceeds with the development of the property as proposed in this matter, it shall do so in compliance with the evidence and testimony presented before the board at the conditional use hearing, and shall meet all applicable ordinances, resolutions, rules, and regulations applicable to the proposed use on the property. Eighth, the applicant shall work with the township engineer and township planner and use its very best efforts to provide a safe pedestrian crosswalk on North Walnut Street to access the Anson B. Nixon Park from the trails on the proposed plan. Ninth, the applicant shall extend the trail on the property in close proximity to a shared property line with tax parcel number 62-4-9 to Baltimore Pike / Miller's Hill to connect to the future sidewalks. And 10th, within 30 days of the date of this decision, the applicant shall pay all outstanding township-related legal, engineering, and administrative fees due to Kennett Township pertaining to this application. Is there such a motion?
I move we approve Stan AB conditional use with the aforementioned conditions.
I'll second.
It's appropriate for discussion at this time. do supervisors who are participating in the vote wish to discuss?
I guess it's the vice chair. I guess if there's any questions or Bob, anyone on the floor?
I think it's commendable to connect to the park there with the walkway. I just want to suggest maybe you can talk to Exelon. They probably want to join in for their employees to get over there. And I would save auto trips.
This is Joe Duffy.
Joe Duffy, sorry.
Any other statements or questions? If not, call for a vote.
Oh, yeah, there's a hand right in front.
Mr. Sander, I just wanted to ask, is this basically in alignment with what the Planning Commission recommended?
I don't know. I didn't compare this decision and the conditions to the Planning Commission's letter. I know that the Planning Commission's letter was considered by the Board of Supervisors in rendering its decision, and some of the specific conditions arose as a result of the hearing information itself that was received by the Board of Supervisors after the Planning Commission had reviewed it and made its recommendation. So I guess it's a combination of the two, but I cannot say for certain that every recommendation that the Planning Commission made is incorporated into the decision.
And I can say that a few of the Planning Commission's recommendations had to do with some of the issues that the applicant addressed with Kaiser. And then quite a few of the Planning Commission's conditions were items that will be addressed at land development stage as well.
Okay. Any other questions?
Jason Nichols, Hazel Ave. I realize that Kaiser had put a lot of his rules what he wanted down. I mean, what about the rest of the area? Are they agreeing to that? The people that live on Hazel Ave and Young Ave?
Well, let me speak to the legal portion of that question. This was an formal application filed by the proposed developer of this parcel, and it was a hearing that was held before the Board of Supervisors that was advertised, that was published in the newspaper, and that was publicized on the website, and exactly how the township publicizes all of its activities and hearings. The only other party to enter his appearance was Mr. Kaiser. Mr. Kaiser hired an attorney. Mr. Kaiser appeared at the hearing, was afforded party status because he is an adjoining property owner, and he had the opportunity to present his concerns and his issues with regard to his property. If others had attended and desired to be a party, whether they had an attorney or not, depending on where you live, you may have been afforded party status and be able to give your concerns. But the supervisors are limited in considering, in making this decision, to the evidence that they heard at the 2+ public hearings that they held on this application, and that's where the decision comes from. So the answer is, the second part of the answer is, this is not an approval of a land development plan. This is not a final approval so that they can go out and start building tomorrow. They needed this approval because in the zoning ordinance, apartments are permitted by what's called conditional use in the BP district, which means it's a use that's allowed, but they have to go before the Board of Supervisors, and the board has to take into consideration any issues that are raised by the public as health, safety, and welfare issues, and also make sure that the applicant meets all of the specific requirements of the zoning ordinance for apartments in the BP district. So that was the purpose of the hearings. That's what the board did, and this is the board's ultimate decision.
Okay, I was only asking that question because he was saying he was representing his neighbors and so forth at one point when I was here. Now, I haven't showed up for a couple of meetings in the last couple of months, so that's why I was asking, because I know he didn't represent me.
No, and I don't think that the board took Mr. Kaiser's appearance and entry as a party and participation in this matter as representing anyone but himself.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Any other questions, comments?
So is this still going to be zoned BP, or it is?
Zoning's unchanged.
Doesn't change.
Zoning's unchanged.
Doesn't change the zone.
And the use, as I said, of apartments is permitted in the BP district. It just had to go through this extra sort of administrative, quasi-judicial step before it got approved. And that's what this is all about right now. But the zoning of the property is the same, and the use is a use permitted by conditional use, and the board is granting conditional use approval. Now they have to go back and file their land development plan and go through the whole process of planning commission reviews and committee reviews and appearances at public hearings and meetings. So this is not a done deal.
So it still stays BP. Do the rules still apply if it was residential development?
The rules of the BP district apply to this use. But the use is now being approved. That's the use. The other elements of this, the filing of a land development plan, have to comply with the subdivision and land development ordinance and other applicable ordinance such as stormwater management, et cetera. And all of those safeguards will be considered by the Board of Supervisors and the Planning Commission as the application goes through the review process.
Would you state your name, please?
I'm sorry. Thank you. Steve Warner.
Thank you.
617 Millersville.
You're a borough resident.
No, he's township.
No, I'm a township resident, sir.
Any other questions or comments? All right, I'll call for a vote.
All in favor, aye.
Aye. So the vote is 2-0 with
2-0
with Stevens recused himself.
Correct. He did not participate in the consideration or decision on the application. The motion is passed 2-0, and the decision will be signed by the supervisors who participated and disseminated to the parties in due course.
Great, thank you. We'll turn the proverbial gavel back to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next thing on the agenda is a TDR ordinance discussion, but I want to move that down to the end of the new business because it may be a more involved discussion. So I'd like to go to a four-way stop intersection at Bayard and Rosedale Roads ordinance, which is 241.
At the September 2nd meeting, the supervisors authorized our township solicitor to draft an ordinance to change the intersection at Bayard and Rosedale Roads into a four-way stop. We had a traffic study done, and it was recommended by our engineer to implement a four-way stop. There were some other changes that they stated that we could make, such as striping on the roads, clearing brush. We've done all that. Since then, there's been several accidents. So the board felt that it is time to implement the four-way intersection. There was a recommendation from the safety committee at their August meeting as well to implement four-way stop. So ordinance 241 is to add stop signs on Rosedale Road, traveling east and west, two stop signs at the intersection of Bayard Road.
I move we approve ordinance 241.
I'll second.
And the effect of that will be to be a four-way stop.
Correct.
Right. The ordinance itself doesn't say anything about a four-way stop, but what it does is it establishes the two crossroads that are not currently stop intersections as stop intersections, thus creating, as a result, a four-way stop intersection.
Is there any discussion, any comments on this?
Yeah, we talked about it last time, that we tried a number of things to make it as safe as possible, and still there's accidents and a number of close calls.
Yes.
And there's limited other things we can do with the roadway, because it's narrow with the bridge on one side and then a sort of a gully before the other side comes up. So there's limited things that we could do. Chief, any other comments?
Yeah.
We tried to brainstorm. I know you were at the safety committee. Yeah, as did Roger, so.
Okay.
The traffic study will be attached to the ordinance.
All right, so hearing no further comments or questions, I'll call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Not opposed? It passes unanimously. Thank you. And then the...
That guy in the black.
I'm going to jump over. I'm going to come back to you.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's okay.
Thank you. Had me worried there. I'd like to go to the deed application for Meadows property.
There's a property that's actually diagonal behind the township building. It's 2.5 acres. There is no home on the property. There is a metal building that's on there. But the owner of that property has offered to give that property to the township. We felt that that was extremely generous, and we really wanted to take advantage of that opportunity, since, you know, it does connect right behind the township building. It's 2.5 acres. We had an environmental study done on the property. The LCAC, our Land Conservation Advisory Committee, recommended to the supervisors that they take ownership of the property. And we also had soil testings done on the property. And at this point, we're ready to proceed to take dedication of the property. The property owner is here tonight. And so we're very excited about this. It's very generous, and we feel that it's time to move forward. So what we would need tonight is for the supervisors to authorize myself and Dave Sander to take appropriate action to get a deed of dedication in place to take ownership of the property.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
So you mentioned the metal building on it. I mean, is that a thing that would stay? And then
no, that would be torn down.
Okay.
Our public works director has already looked into that, and he and the road crew guys, along with some assistants, are going to be able to remove it pretty
okay.
easily.
And then what are you going to do with the property when you get
we
it?
Just
is it dedicated or just open? Okay.
And, you know, they may, I'm not sure what they'll do with it. They may put an easement on in the future. I don't
yeah.
know. We're just starting at the beginning of the process.
Just curious.
Yeah.
More than anything.
But we're not going to build anything on it.
Gotcha. Okay. Any other comments or questions? I ask for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And aye as well. And with great appreciation.
Thank you, Sarah.
Yes.
Thanks, Sarah.
Okay. Yeah. This is very generous.
I'm happy to do it.
And that then brings us to the final item of new business, the TDR ordinance discussion. John, would you like to join us in this?
We've been working on a transfer of development right ordinance. I'm not sure if everyone here knows what that is, but John Snook is here in front row. He works for the Brandywine Conservancy. He drafted the ordinance for us. We have been working on it for many months with the supervisors, the Planning Commission, John Snook, and other consultants. So he's going to explain what TDRs are, and we're going to discuss the ordinance where it stands now. Our hope is tonight that we'll be at a point that the supervisors are satisfied with this draft, that we can send it on to the Planning Commission for their review process. for their, which we would send to them by October 1st. Thank you, John. Thanks for coming.
You're welcome.
Do you want to sit up here?
Glad it worked out. That's all right.
Yeah.
It might be easier.
Absolutely, I can give you my.
Has the board, to what extent would you like me to just outline the basics versus what you may have discussed previously at a?
Yeah, if you could just outline, just basically for the audience, what TDR is, and what the.
John, I think that we're fairly, we board.
Right.
Fairly familiar with TDRs in general, and specifically the work that you've done for us as amended most recently within the last week. So I think that there may be a desire to ask some questions about that. I'm not sure. I'm just saying that may happen.
Totally.
But I think it's important that we have on the record for the audience, so that they understand what this is about.
And 2 weeks ago, we discussed where we stood with the ordinance then. So it'd be appropriate just to discuss the change that we need to make.
Okay. Well, for the sake of the audience, very briefly, and certainly questions would be welcome to make it less brief, if it's too brief. The idea, a transferable development right, a TDR, is literally that. It's a development right that could have been utilized on a property that you or the landowner wishes to preserve and is being transferred to another property that is zoned for development. The way this is, the proposal is set up, and the finalization of the map of sending parcels has actually not been fully determined by the board, but the idea is that larger tracts over 10 acres, for the most part.
Could I show them the map right here?
Yeah, and I brought maps for
that.
You, but they're small.
Right, but basically this is the sending areas down here, mainly where there's R1 and some R2.
Predominantly would be R1 or R2 properties that also have been mapped on your, your key conservation zones mapping, which is a mapping of properties that are important for conservation based on their environmental characteristics largely. And the rights would be severed from the sending property at basically the same rate that they might have been developed on that property. So, although it's slightly skewed to give an incentive to sever rather than to develop, but very slightly. So, for example, just to make it simple, if someone could build 5 houses, they have 5 TDRs to transfer. Where do they get transferred to? As drafted, they would get transferred to either the BP, the C, or the LI districts.
These areas up here next to these,
which are all but the borough and are already zoned, both zoned for development and also in your comprehensive plan, future land use noted as appropriate locations for development. What would be permitted with the received rights is a certain level of increased intensity over what otherwise would be permitted by the base zoning, with limitations. You might be able to add a story, you might be able to add a little bit more building coverage or a bigger parking lot. You would still have to have open ground to meet your stormwater management requirements. Or in the case of multifamily dwellings, you could increase the density through the receipt of rights. For non-residential receipt, each TDR gleaned from an R1 or R2 property is worth a certain number of square footage for non-residential receipt, whether that be building square footage or square footage of an additional story or square footage of, say, a larger parking lot. For residential receipt, it's based on, it's not really a formula, but it's scaled such that, for example, you might get two apartments for one TDR and one and a half townhouses, that kind of thing, recognizing that the value of the TDR, if it were a unit back in the R1 or R2, is worth quite a bit more than the value of the marginal value of that individual unit in the receiving zone. So that's the basic concept. Since it was last discussed, I believe in the public meeting.
2 weeks ago.
Okay. Working with Lisa, based on comments from the board, we made a number of changes. Number one, eliminating notes, which were informative notes, to put it in literal ordinance format. One of the issues that the board asked me to address was to include a provision that where a landowner wished to apply, the township would cover the cost of calculation of how many TDRs they have. Now, the reason I had originally suggested that as an idea was once people know how many they have, it's going to be a lot easier for them to think about selling them and therefore preserving their land. Because the result, when the TDRs are severed from a property, a conservation easement is placed on that property to the extent of how many rights were removed. And so then you have effectively created a conservation program without using public dollars to buy the easements, but letting the marketplace buy them for you. Okay, so, and Lisa had asked me to guesstimate, I had told her an example how Honeybrook Township, for example, does this. They pay their engineer up to $300 to calculate the TDRs on any given property. I asked our staff, not that they need to do it, but just by way of example, because they have full access to the county GIS database, and it just based on the time it would take, they felt it could be done for about, on average, $200 per property. It would be caveated that, obviously, the accuracy of the calculation is only as good as the information supplied. Now, so the ordinance does allow for a landowner to undergo the calculation on their own, hire their own engineer or surveyor, but in most cases, given that it takes 2 to 3 acres to generate one TDR, there's a lot of room for there to be a little bit of error in the general available information before someone's going to manage to survey their way into more units, more TDRs. So I certainly wouldn't suggest that people do that, but there may be extraordinary circumstances where it would be worth their while to do that. They may agree to accept the township's estimate. And that, I don't think we need to write that anymore. We might want to write that in about in the certification process that the number generated would be certified based on mutual agreement. Well, the way we have it set now, it's based on what the applicant presents. Assuming they're going to take the town what the township has paid for, that's what they would be presenting. So I don't know that we need to name
The endorsement shall not be unreasonably withheld upon receipt by the township of all information necessary for accurate determination of the validity of the proposed severance, mm-hmm. number of TDRs.
So,
and typically this would apply to parcels of 10 acres or more.
Yes. The way, as we've discussed today, and I do have a map that shows that I can give the board and listener,
pizza. And I can hold one up. And it's really, even at this size, and looking at the map that Rich was pointing out to you, it's not frankly difficult to figure out what's happening. I'll just hold this up. What you see, and the reason I suggested a specific map of sending parcels as opposed to a narrative description of the criteria that make it one is because with a map that the board adopts as a separate document, the board can add or subtract properties as it wishes without amending the ordinance by incorporating this map, which would be called the Kennett Township TDR sending area map, into the ordinance by reference. Now, what's shown on this map, the yellow properties are R1 properties exceeding 10 acres. The orange properties are R2 properties exceeding 10 acres. And the green properties are properties already preserved through your open space programs and land trust open space efforts within Kennett Township, as well as open space within developments. Now, what is excluded is, with one error, is that institutional properties are excluded. And that's another reason why, adopting a map, the board can exclude or include properties that it wishes based on other public policy issues.
What is an institution? Does that include a trust?
Well, the way, in terms of how this map was done, you could do that. It was mainly excluding large institutional lands. And the one that isn't excluded that is on there, you'll notice, is the elementary school on Greenwood Road. And the reason is those properties that we all think of as being used and not necessarily developed, but you don't want them, in a sense, flooding the market with TDRs when they don't intend to develop in the first place. You want the sale of TDRs to go to people who can't afford to voluntarily preserve their land and need to sell the TDRs or sell the conservation easement through your township open space program, for example, or to the kind of area land trust, for example, or land trust that's of interest to your county, for example.
So this is a voluntary program, and it's an option for homeowners if they theoretically could stay in the property.
Absolutely. Because the TDRs can be severed, and the person can keep the property. It's the same as if someone donates a conservation easement, they still keep their property. And there may be, for people who are sufficiently wealthy, there are tax benefits to doing that. But for people who are not so wealthy, they might not be able to afford to give away what, for example, they might consider their retirement package in their land value. So. And as Rich said, it's entirely voluntary. It's voluntary under the law in Pennsylvania. And it's simply an option. Now, what could also be done at the discretion of the board, for example, on the one hand, certain institutional properties were excluded. What you probably from the audience can't see, some of the parcels are outlined in red. Those are the parcels that all or partially are included on your key conservation zones mapping, which is an effort done, I believe, by the EAC. And also, was it done with the Land Conservation
Committee? The Land Conservation Advisory Committee,
yeah.
Did the mapping.
And because since you've identified those as important conservation areas, in a sense, it's logical for them to take priority. So my first suggestion is that only those properties actually be mapped initially, and then if there are other R1 or R2 properties that you believe are important, that they might be added. And if there are smaller properties less than 10 acres, that are important because of their relationship to the conservation zone mapping, they might also be included. The only thing to remember in thinking about that is that a property as small as 10 acres is going to generate very few TDRs in the first place. You know, it's only going to generate 2 or 3 TDRs, so it gets to a point where it's hardly worth it, but once in a while there may be a case. And just like amending the official map, there's no reason why, however, if the landowner approached you and said, I really want to see my property conserved, I can't afford to just give away a conservation easement, this map could be amended and they could be added to it. So that's just a little overview of the Massachusetts. The map would be adopted as a separate item the way the text is drafted. It would not actually be part of the ordinance text.
But it would be incorporated by reference.
Absolutely.
Into the ordinance. Okay.
Yes. And in fact, the way the draft says is the sending area lot or lots from which TDRs are to be severed shall be located within the TDR sending area map approved and revised from time to time by Kennett Township.
Okay.
It would be absolutely be incorporated by reference. We also discussed an issue about partial severance. What if I own 20 acres and I only sever the rights on 10 of them and sell those? And then I turn around and I divide my 20 acres into nice big 5-acre lots instead of the 3-acre zoning or 2-acre zoning, depending on the district, which wouldn't necessarily meet the township's conservation objectives. And the person would be getting money for not meeting the conservation objectives. So we added, in this most recent draft, a provision that says that it shall be the burden of the landowner requesting endorsement of partial severance to demonstrate to the satisfaction of the township that the portion of the property to be subject to conservation easement as a result of TDR severance shall meet the township's conservation objectives. So that it's not like what happened in East Nottingham, and some of you know, the board knows, I've been involved in probably 20 TDR ordinances in mostly southeastern Pennsylvania. And one of the townships I've been involved with, East Nottingham, they discovered that when they allowed for partial severance, they had farms severing the TDRs on the ponds and the wetlands that couldn't be developed, and keeping the rest. And that was not meeting their conservation. So that's obviously an extreme example, but just to give you an example of why we added that provision. We also adjusted the proposed receiving density for multifamily residential development. I had noted a few minutes ago that one TDR would be equated to a higher number of units for that kind of unit just because of the valuation issues. We also felt that it would be a good idea to give an extra jump, if you will, for age-restricted residences because they generate less community impact. Notably, obviously, not that we don't like them, but they don't generate school children, and they typically have fewer trips per day and even less sewer and water usage. Often the units are smaller, so there's less footprint, less impervious cover per unit, and so forth. So this most recent draft makes the receiving rate, one TDR shall be received for 3 additional multifamily dwellings where age restricted, or for 2 additional multifamily dwellings where not age-restricted. Obviously, part of the formal amendment will need to be a clear definition of what constitutes age-restricted. We also allowed for increase in height. The current height limits range from 35 to 48, depending on zoning district and use. We, in this draft, and remember this is a draft, we allowed for an increase to 50 feet, where every square foot of the building that exceeds the base height limit in the zoning district would be subject to receipt of TDRs on the basis of one TDR per 3,000 square feet or portion thereof. In other words, so if I received 3,050 square feet, I needed, that would be two TDRs. So when I go to the next, into the next realm, it's another TDR. Okay. We also then set that in certain instances, and we limited that, I believe, to the LI and C districts, not the BP. That building, which are right on the edge of borough, which has higher buildings already, that a building could exceed 50 feet up to, is it 60? 60. Up to 60 feet with receipt again of TDR for the square footage. But you couldn't apply the same TDR to both leaps. In other words, up to 50 would take some TDRs and up to 60 would take another round of TDRs. In doing that, we also added that a building over 50 feet would have to be set further back from any neighboring property owner, 2 feet for every 1 foot that it exceeded 50 feet. And we clarified that, however, that that only applied to the portion of the building that exceeded 50 feet. So in other words, if you had a building that had a higher wing and a lower wing, and the lower wing was under 50 feet, it would not have to have that extra setback, just the part. Or if you imagine a building like a wedding cake, not that we necessarily want to see those, but that would be a way that you could address that increased setback for height. And the reason to do that is obviously as it gets higher, it's mainly the sun angle, the shadow. You want it to be farther away from the nearby property line so as not to cast a shadow on the neighbor. And in that vein, we also added in this draft a new provision, and this receipt is subject to conditional use approval, such as the approval you just witnessed earlier tonight, which is only a permission to then submit a land development plan, as your solicitors have reminded us. We added in that the township may, I put may, but at the township's discretion, or suggested may, simply because there may clearly be situations where you might not need to do this, but the township may require a visual impact assessment, including a sunshadow assessment, so that you can make sure that you're not unduly impacting neighboring property owners. A lot of times that's going to depend on the topography. You look at, for example, the Exelon buildings, the way they're sort of down in a hollow almost, and even though they're large buildings, just on Baltimore Pike coming in to Kennett from Longwood, you don't really see them as big as they actually are, because they're set back far from the public road, and they're low relative to the surrounding topography. So there are other means to mitigate impact other than just setback, for example. And the way I suggested writing that was, at the discretion of the township, in cases of proposed increase height through TDR receipt, a visual assessment may be required of the applicant to assess impacts to views from off-site as well as potential sunshadow impacts onto neighboring properties. Architectural treatment or introduced landscaping may be required to mitigate impacts as a condition of approval. And those were all the changes made from earlier drafts discussed.
You
change it from 1.5 to 2.
On the, yeah, oh, sorry. Yes, Scudder, thank you for reminding me. I mentioned that we changed the receiving rate from for multifamily from 2 per TDR to 2 normally and 3 if it's age restricted. We also, in this draft, I also changed up to a maximum density from it was 1.5 times the base density to 2 times the base density. Because if you're receiving 3 units per TDR, you're going to quickly add the density, but this essentially is only applicable to, it's only applicable to multifamily dwellings, which have a small footprint. So that increase in gross density, and you still have to meet all the other area and bulk requirements, should not, in most cases, be excessive. But again, it would be subject to conditional use.
Okay, so we have a motion on the floor, correct? We don't.
We don't.
The motion would be to do what? To turn this over?
Move it forward.
To move it forward.
To, the motion would be to authorize Dave to put it in the final ordinance format to send it off to the planning commission by October 1st for the formal review. It will also go to the LCEC for their review.
Okay. Would you be sending it on to the county?
Chester County Planning Commission as well.
The same,
yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Required.
It's a zoning ordinance.
As opposed to, yeah. You know, waiting.
And sure.
Like that. Yeah. This is a zoning ordinance amendment, so it's got to be treated as such. It has to be reviewed 30 days minimum by the local and county planning commissions, and has to be advertised twice for 2 successive weeks for a public hearing before the Board of Supervisors, before it's enacted.
And that will be done in November.
And we've had,
correct.
We've had a lot of interactions with the planning commission,
yes.
On this. So I'd like to make a motion for the township manager and the lawyer to draft this as an ordinance. Does it get advertised?
Solicitor.
No, not
solicitor.
Yet.
Not listed.
Well, you can authorize it to be prepared, sent to the planning commissions for the appropriate review, and advertised for a public hearing.
Because the public hearing will be in November.
Okay. So
is there some reason why you would not want to do that?
No.
No.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So we already had a lot of discussion. Is there any other discussion?
Why not include R4 in the receiving area as a receiving area? It seems to me, and I guess I have a question related to R4. I'm not, are apartments allowed a use by right in R4? So it seems to me that I'm a developer. I want to build an apartment building. In the BP district, it's conditional use. In the R4, I can just go start planning an apartment building. Now, so that's one step that I don't have to go through in the development. And I want to, if R4 is then available to me, it might be more attractive to me as a developer to go ahead and buy some TDRs for me to use in an R4 district. And certainly the R4 districts that we have are situated in areas that are amenable to higher density development, just like the BP and the LI and the rest of it. So why not include R4 as a receiving district?
My quick response is that the goal of the board was to do a TDR and get it in place in some conservative fashion so that we could live with it and see how it plays out and fine-tune it, tweak it as time goes on. So we tried to limit it to sending areas and receiving areas so that it was kind of focused, mm-hmm. and not as broadly done as it could possibly have been done. Mm-hmm. Your suggestion, which may be good, mm-hmm. But we haven't evaluated it in terms of of including R3 or R4 or other areas in the process. We just tried to take the most obvious ones and put them into effect. That was the goal. And it may be that, that's what we should be doing a year from now or in 5 years from now after we've lived with it for a little bit. Mm-hmm. But the concern was that it becomes more unwieldy. There are too many other pieces in play if we start adding, expanding the parameters. Mm-hmm. That's my quick answer. Does anybody else, John, do you have some thoughts?
Well, I would only say, we did discuss that. We discussed all of the districts that the comp plan and future land use map calls for development, which would include the R4. And as Gutter just said, essentially it was more, well, let's get something that we think is workable and see how it works before we make it too big in its applicability. And I don't disagree with that. And the other angle is, in that trial, if you will, sort of a trial basis, the R4 has a lot of existing residents already. So it has a lot more potential neighbor issues than the properties, even though there are residences in the other districts. Mm-hmm. But though the R4 is presently essentially exclusively residential, and so the thinking from my perspective was, let's not get too far ahead of ourselves and sort of discover that we've created something we can't live with.
Okay. Does anybody want to add to this at all?
I'm going to say the map will be easy to modify at any time.
Right.
Once we have ordinance in place.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So I agree with the fire safety.
Okay. I think you had a question.
No. Belinda Thanks. Carter, Kennett Township. I asked this month or so ago, and I went back and did a little more homework, and it's probably my ignorance, but how does... the referendum that we voted on in 2005 gave the guidance to develop TDRs. If you look at the amended act, I think which we voted in for open space.
The open space.
But it set forth guidance for TDRs. It appears to. Well, there's something in there. Now, that's where I may be wrong. Does that have... I just wondered, is there any impact? I mean, I was told, no, this is the way it goes and for TDRs. But I was just trying to rationalize that in my mind.
I don't understand. Is there any impact of what on what?
Well, there's some guidance about what township appears to be able to do or not do with TDRs. But that was a number of years ago.
Well, let's clarify.
And severability and the township taking
over. The Act 153.
You're talking about the
open space tax. No,
I'm not.
You're not.
Well, yeah, it is the open space tax, but that's if you look at this, it does.
Not TDRs.
Well, it does address transferable development rights.
Is there language that you have specifically in the referendum that refers to TDRs that we could take a look at?
I just have the act that was in place that we voted on. And that you maybe tell me that doesn't.
That
the amended act was one, two,
I don't know what the wording of the township referendum was. The act is Act 153, which is the Open Space Act.
The
act as amended does allow you, the municipality, to use revenue collected to purchase interest in open space, which the Act defines as including transferable development rights. So yes, the township could use those funds once this ordinance is in place to itself purchase and potentially bank TDRs. But the ordinance is also set up to work so entirely in the private marketplace. So it's not presupposing use of township funds, but it wouldn't exclude that.
I'm having a little trouble about severability into conservation easement with the township.
Well, the
without
township
trouble understanding that.
In several
disagreeing necessarily.
Several discussions, There are a number of ordinances out there that simply require some kind of deed restriction, for example. I discussed this with board members and Lisa, and the feeling was, since this is an option, it's not mandatory, that the township can require that the severance be affirmed, essentially, by the establishment of a conservation easement. So the result will be the same as it would be if you purchased a conservation easement with your open space program, except typically when you do that, you just essentially retire the TDRs. Well, there are no TDRs right now. Once there are TDRs, the township can buy them and hold them and sell them at a later day. And there are townships doing that. Warwick Township, Lancaster County, has seen over 900 TDRs severed and has purchased them themselves, the township, and has sold back several hundred to developers and rolled that money back into their open space program. So, but it's not required that the township play a monetary role.
Yeah, no, thank you. I can talk this more offline. I just was trying to rationalize it like that.
Hi, yes. Diane McGovern, Kennett Township. What's the price for the TDR? Is it a market price?
There will be. Here's the odd duck thing about that, and that's a very good question. Initially, the only logical way to appraise the TDRs would be to appraise it as the purchase of a conservation easement, and then divide that over the TDRs that are available as to a per TDR price. Because the only real comps are going to be conservation easement purchases. Once there's a market moving and you have people using the TDRs, then arguably the sale price should also in part reflect the value on the other end. But that we really can't predetermine until it starts to happen.
So you always have to have a buyer and a seller lined up.
Right. Correct. It's a willing buyer, willing seller.
It's a market. You're exactly right. It is a market. The market establishes the price.
Joe, you had your hand.
Yeah, Joe Duffy. Now, how do the senders find the receivers, the sellers and the buyer?
Well, one of the reasons that we discussed the township offering to pay for the calculation of TDRs is that then the township also has a record of who's has now indication of how many TDRs they have. And then someone wanting to buy them could obviously contact those people. And then when those people are contacted, they already know what they have, and so they're one step along in the process. But there's nothing to force anyone to act.
Thank you. Rick Farquhar, Kennett Township. Two questions. If your property is already in Act 319, what's that do to you? And the second one is, what's the difference between this program and going into a land trust?
Well, the main difference, I'll tackle the second question first, because your first question would have the same answer in either case. The going into a land trust, if the land trust is purchasing the easement from you at a fair market value based on an easement appraisal, then there's essentially no difference to you. Your land is being conserved, you can still live there, the development rights from your standpoint are gone. The difference is, this allows a land trust, a township, or a private party to purchase the development rights that then can be sold for use or used elsewhere, and therefore have additional value. So it brings additional money to the table. Land trusts obviously don't have unlimited funds. And so this ideally brings more money to the table to purchase development rights. As far as 319 goes, it should have no effect as long as you're not subdividing the property. So far, Chester County has not viewed the severance of TDRs as constituting a subdivision.
It's a separate estate in land. You've got land, you've got the mineral rights under your land, if there are any that have been interpreted by the court to be a separate estate. Transferable development rights are, by estate law, created by ordinance, and once they're created, they're a separate estate so that you can sell just them. And that's the whole idea behind the TDRs. You're not selling your property in fee simple to a buyer where they now own it and you don't. You're selling, you're separating your right to develop your property as a separate estate in land, and you're selling that to a willing buyer, and a deed of transferable development rights is actually recorded in the Recorder of Deeds office. So that's how this is different than just a, you know, signing a conservation easement. And it's not a subdivision, as Mr. Smuck said. It's your 319 is your, yeah, what does it have to be, 10 acres or more?
Yes.
You know, you're still going to own the 10 acres. It just can't be developed. But the goal of 319 is to promote the preservation of open land or agricultural land, and that wouldn't change if you sold the development rights to it.
Any other questions? Any other comments? Hearing, seeing none, call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
As well as I am in favor. Passes unanimously. Thank you, John.
Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
Appreciate
you.
Pleasure.
And thanks to all of you for helping to bring it to the surface.
You never know.
That brings us to Roadwork. And Roger's not going to be with us, apparently.
It's not here yet.
Who was going to be
there? I'll read it.
Okay.
They've installed 4-inch drain pipe, along with digging up 8 other pipes and black topping them with base material before the paving starts. Paving is going to start first week in October. We're cutting it close. They repaired a sinkhole in the Quintera development. There was a pipe joint opened up. One tree was down on York Road, which they cut and chipped up. A new sign was installed at Anson Nixon Park for the dedication of their new playground. The new program of sealing, slurry seal it's called, was done on several roads by asphalt paving systems. Ashford Drive, Milkwood Drive, Balmoral Drive, Renly, Leslie Road, and South Street. This was a new product. We had a few issues with the first application, but it seems to be straightened out since then, and the rest of the application looks good. The mowing has started and will be wrapped up in the next 2 weeks. The line painting was done for the year, including crosswalks and stop bars at the red light intersection. This was done by Alpha Space Control, who is the contractor that won the bid. Just so you know, there's an area right by the entrance to Bayard Estates on Bayard Road that looks like somebody ran through line painting, and there's white paint all over the road. Several people have white paint on their cars from that. That it was not our line painting. That was way before our line painting was done, and what happened was a contractor dumped a 5-gallon bucket of paint all over it.
Wow.
The road crew reinstalled crosswalks on South Street after the new surface was applied, and crosswalks on Chandler Mill Road and all of Pennsylvania were done. The yard waste pile was ground up and hauled away by Weaver Mulch. This is done for free, and the total tons was 515.
Tons.
This was the second time this year.
Wow.
A total of 1,090 tons of material was ground in 2015. The paving project, as I say, I said the first week in October, it's October 12th, which will take 2 weeks to complete. The roads are sky view, all of the roads in Longwood Crossing, East Hillendale Road between the Farland and Bayard Road, and two sections of Rosedale Road will have an overlay put on it. New stop signs were installed in Woodchuck Way, at Deer Path, Possum Tree, Turkey Hollow, and Chipmunk Lane.
I wanted to comment that the use of the slurry or other approaches as opposed to gravel and tar is, from my point of view, a major improvement. I was driving into Westchester today as an example on my bike. And I was on one of the back roads through East Marlboro, and they had just tarred and chipped the roads, and that's not pleasant in a car, because the whole time you're driving, you're hearing the rocks rattling off at the bottom of the finish of your car. On a bike, and particularly a big bike on gravel, it is very dangerous. And when I was running for office 4 years ago, there were numerous residents that were quite concerned about their kids being able to ride skateboards in their developments because it was all chipped and tarred and the problems that caused. So there's been some transitional difficulties getting to this point, but I'm very pleased that we're there. So please tell Roger that I am pleased.
And I also, Roger is not here, his mother passed away. And so I just want to offer our sympathy to his entire family.
Joe?
One question, Lisa. The green street signs, is that program still alive?
It is.
Okay.
At first, we had to have them all installed by 2012. Then it moved to 2013. It keeps moving up a year, so we're doing as many as we can each year, but it's very expensive, so we're just trying to get it done as we go along.
Thank you.
I wanted to announce one other thing. We're going to host a trails planning and management seminar on October 5th downstairs here. It won't be for the public to attend. It will be for committees, supervisors, organizations that implement trails. So I will be sending out an invitation to the supervisors if they want to attend, and our Trails and Sidewalk Committee, our Land Conservancy, the Land Conservancy, and our Land Conservation Advisory Committee, and some other committee members, invite them to attend.
That's Monday.
That will be Monday, October 5th, from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m.
And that is
a lot of traffic.
That is a conference, as it were, an information gathering event, and not a time for discussion of agency business.
That's correct.
Is that it?
That's all I have to say.
Okay, so that then brings us to the end of our official business and down to public comment. Is there any public comment?
I just have a question. It's just a curiosity question. Dave Adamson, 621 North Hill. Ms. Moore, the 500 tons of mulch, was that tons by weight or cubic tons?
I don't know, but I can find
it. Got it. It's got to be cubic tons. When you say tons, yeah. When you say yards, it's cubic. It's always cubic. I mean, I don't
think they weigh it.
They say
it's done
they
by
do.
Area.
They say they do.
I think it's a cubic. I think it's cubic.
Yeah, I can find out.
I've contacted them before. They never weigh anything.
Okay.
It's still probably a lot.
That's a lot. That's
okay.
The pile was huge. It was.
Yeah,
it
was. That's right.
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah.
That's
a
good job.
Any other questions, comments for the good welfare?
When did you say Hill and Dale was going to be paved?
October 12th.
Starting.
Starting for 2 weeks.
Depending on when.
Correct.
Is that going to impact the residents at all?
You'll still be able to get out.
Okay.
You know, they'll make sure that everybody's notified a week ahead of time. And they're going to have a really nice sign that notifies of paving.
Not like the other one?
Not like the other one. Yes.
Oh.
Yes, they are.
Abby Kessler, just a random question. So this afternoon I looked at the information packet and I think it still has 9-1 TDR jobs. Can that be replaced with this updated one?
Well, if you go to the ordinances, the newest one's there.
Is it? Okay.
9-14.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes. Thank you.
Do I see a hand over on this side? Hearing no other questions or comments, do I have a motion?
So moved.
To adjourn?
To adjourn.
Second.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.